Yeah, so and on that topic of numbers, so I want to bring up something that I've noticed, because one thing I do is I investigate people. I investigate artists, I investigate numbers, I investigate competition, potential competition, people been I just like to see what's going on in the industry. And the one of the best ways to do that is looking at someone's numbers. And so one of the things I like to look at, I like looking at Spotify numbers. And the reason why I like looking at Spotify numbers is, well, for one thing, Spotify is the number one streaming platform. And so that is going to give me a good idea of how a particular artist is being received and how popular they actually are, because more people stream music now than they download music and or purchase CDs. So Spotify is kind of a good window to see how
Who's
someone.
active, how active they are, or if I guess is a good, like you said, it's a good window to see what they're really doing.
Right, because I'll see artists who will state that they're doing X, Y, and Z as far as numbers. They got this many fans, they're doing this and this. But I go to their Spotify, and I mean, you got 150 monthly listeners, but yet your YouTube videos got 100,000 views and not much comment activity going on. And these are the type of things where I'm like, okay, someone's faking their shit in one regard, and the other platform is kind of showing me the true numbers as far as are people checking them out. But you can't fake your Spotify numbers, but it's easy to pick out the people who are faking like Spotify numbers, because so one of the cool things Spotify has, if you're a fan, is they have the option called Related Artists. So let's say I click on Insane Poetry. I'm a big fan of Insane Poetry. I'm streaming it, and I'm like, man, I like this music. What else can I listen to that's like Insane Poetry? Well, I go down to the related artist and I click on it. It says, oh, Scum. Oh, Liquid Assassin. Oh, Esham.
Yeah,
You
real
know,
shit.
these different people. And so this tells me, if I like Insane Poetry, these other artists I'm gonna dig too. It's a great feature, but when you see someone that has, because I've seen artists like, how the hell do you have 5,000 monthly listeners? You don't even have it. You have like one record out, and I don't see any buzz around you at all. What's going on? So I'm like, man, that
There's no
seems
bees, there's no buzzards,
right.
there's nothing buzzing around.
And so I'm like, wow, that just seems kind of weird. So I'll look at the profile, and one thing you can do is you look at their related artists. And so I've seen some of these people that have numbers on Spotify that just look a little fishy. And I go to their related artists, and they'll be a rap artist, but their related artists are like, these are no name unknown. They got like a polka artist, a country artist. Ranchero
EDM,
music,
yeah.
yeah, EDM, like a whole bunch of shit that makes no sense being related. And you click on, I'll click on these other artists just to see what they're about. And a lot of times they'll not have any numbers at all. Like their numbers are super low. And what it is there are platforms out there that will allow you to purchase Spotify plays, or more than that,
Playlist, yeah, on that
get
play.
put on Spotify playlists. So what they do is, you pay whatever fee, and they put you on this playlist. And a lot of times the playlist is played by bots, or it's a mixture of bots and accounts run by people in India or overseas shit. These are not people who care anything about your music. Same shit as the Click Farm, Facebook shit, or the YouTube shit. But what happens is when you pay to get on a Spotify playlist and get these fake plays by people who don't give a fuck about your music, you're on a playlist with other people who've paid to get on a playlist to boost their numbers and get this quote unquote fake exposure. So what happens is it totally throws your metrics off with your related artists. So this shortcut that some people think is out there to be like, shit, I'll just pay to get on a playlist and I'll get a bunch of listeners. It'll boost my monthly listeners. It'll boost my streams. And I can tell people, hey, look at my numbers. I'm doing great on Spotify. But you're actually fucking off your metrics, because if you had done shit the right way and built it up slowly and done the promotion you're supposed to do, people who listen to other underground acts would be listening to you, and you would get linked up with those other underground artists who do music just like you, and you would actually get discovered in an organic way that would bring you real fans. But
real fans.
But instead, you do some fake shit, and you've actually killed your metrics to be discovered. You utilizing Spotify as a discovery tool for fans to actually discover your music. Plus, I look at you as a weenie, because I know your shit is fake as fuck, and right. I've seen this. I've seen people do this, and every time I see it, I laugh, because I'm like, maybe you're getting over on some people, but I see the fakery going on.
That won't last long. That won't last long, and I see, you know, like I said, the name of this podcast is Numbers Don't Lie, and this is not strictly regulated or this is strictly not just about Spotify and all and everything. And Spotify is just a really good platform, because you actually get revenue from Spotify.
Right.
But I see guys do this on Instagram and all that.
Yeah.
And, speaking of that, I saw numbers on Instagram of an artist, and I remember that artist would post things on Instagram and they'd have 10, 15, you know, views or whatever. And then one day, month later, anything the person posted had 500-600 people
right.
liking the post. And I'm like, well, hell, that's a 600% jump.
Yeah, right.
So I'm like, let me investigate.
Right.
So all I did was go to the likes, hit the likes, and see who liked it. Because
right.
I wanted to know if
right.
some of my friends
right.
were liking that shit.
Right.
Well, guess what? Who was liking his shit? People in India.
Right, yep.
People in Pakistan.
Right, yep.
And all in places where I don't think the language even is, it's like,
it doesn't translate.
It doesn't translate to, and this is what JP was alluding to. It really is like, it makes you look like a weenie.
Well, and the thing is, like, and if you click on those profiles, you'll see that they have either no followers themselves, mm-hmm. or they're not very active. I mean, these are click farm things, the same way people used to do the Facebook likes. It's the same thing on Instagram. I personally know someone, unfortunately, I hate to say this, someone I used to do music with in the past does this shit, and I saw this on, I have him as a friend on Instagram, and I saw the same shit. The dude posted up a picture of whatever the fuck he posted up, and I swear to God, within 2 minutes, it had 800 plus likes. And I'm like, how the fuck do you have 800 plus likes 2 minutes after you post a picture?
Tech9 don't even got that. Don't do that. I mean, he gets it eventually within an hour.
Right.
I mean, it's going to build. But in 2 minutes, no.
And so, you know, I did the same thing you did. I was like, well, man, who are these people following? Because shit, I want to make friends with them.
Right.
I want these people to like my shit.
Right.
So I did the investigation. I clicked, and the same shit. It was, you know, a lot of Middle Eastern profiles, Indian profiles. You know, and I was like, okay, this dude is doing the fake shit. Now, my thing is, I don't even understand why rappers do the I mean, I understand why, like, models do it. And I catch some of these online Facebook, Instagram, bathroom selfie models, whatever, doing this shit.
bathroom selfie. Great description.
You know, I see them doing it, and I understand, I guess, to some degree why, because they think, you know, if you get exposure, maybe you get a photographer or whatever being like, oh, this girl's getting a lot of hits. Maybe I want to do some shit with her. I guess, I don't know. But when it comes to rappers, you don't get paid off Instagram. And if it's not equating to new people discovering you, why the fuck would you fake your Instagram numbers? I don't get it. And other than to be like, hey, look at me, I've got whatever amount of people liking my shit, but it doesn't equate to money, and it doesn't equate to real new fans. So I don't know who investigates Instagram and says, oh, this dude has 2,000 likes on a picture of Nikes that he just bought. I gotta get this. I gotta book this dude for my show. But literally, that's what it is. But I guess
he got the new Nike Shocks.
He got
he got the 2018 version.
And you know, I don't get it. And I guess you can do some automated shit where you pay for something and like as soon as you put up a post, it click farms a bunch of likes on the shit. But I don't understand like the Instagram shit. What you possibly think you're gonna get as a musician doing the shit on Instagram, especially because we all know that goes down. So why fake it? Why not just do the work and actually make friends with people on Instagram, have interaction, hit them up, and you know, create it organically?
Well, what I did notice is these people that do that on Instagram that have those kind of you know, pumped up or, you know, super inflated numbers, they never go live on Instagram.
Right. Right.
Because the real will happen.
Right, right.
That's when the exposure will
you'll
happen.
You'll see two people logged into their live shit when they got 800 likes on their post. No, right. I agree. I mean, I think the real deal is there's nothing with being confident and pumping yourself and saying, hey, look, you know, I really feel like I got a lot of talent. I'm willing to do work. I get myself on shows, you know, I'm trying to collab with a lot of different people, do all these things. There's nothing wrong with having a healthy, confident, ego, and knowing your worth, but that's the whole key, knowing your worth at the time. Don't game on other people and try to pump yourself to be more than what you are, because in the end, people are going to feel cheated. They're going to feel lied to. And actually, even if you get them on the come up this one time, you've probably burned a bridge to not do business with them ever again in whatever capacity that is, whether it's another artist working with you, a promoter booking you, fans coming to your show, because maybe you convince some fans you're the next big thing and some shit they need to check out. They come see your stage show and your shit looks amateur as fuck. And they're like, oh, you're not, you know, you're not on Tech Nine level or Scum level or whatever. Like, your shit is not cracking.
You know what, another example of that was worse is the rapper that used to be the shit.
Right.
Had all these accolades way back in the day.
Right.
But they're doing music now. They don't get none of those kind of activities. And they succumb to, let me obliviate my numbers or do this and all that. And they because they've been in the game, they're like, what they did back in 1992, and it's 2018, they haven't done nothing since then.
Right.
They want you to say, oh, my resume is this long, blah, blah, blah. Well, here's the real. It's all about getting asses in the seats to the promoters and venue owners.
Right.
If you're not getting asses in the building and you're an older artist and all of that, and you're demanding these things and this and that, and I should have this and I should have that. I'm an older artist and I don't do that shit because it really makes everybody not want to fuck with you.
Well, and speaking on that, as far as numbers don't lie, I'm not sure that you can pump your numbers from 20 years ago today. I think that's a problem because you have artists who, you know, had a little buzz or were affiliated with a situation maybe 20 years ago and had people who gave a fuck. But guess what? The people who gave a fuck, they're in their 40s now or whatever. Most of them don't even, they're not that they're not fans of music, but they're not active fans. They got families, they got real life shit. They're not coming to a bunch of shows.
No, they're not.
They're not actively hunting out brand new music from these artists that they followed, you know, way back when. I mean, I'm going to ask, you know, people listening to this podcast, obviously you're a fan of music because you're listening to this, but if you're over the age of 40, are you as active with following and seeking out new music as you were when you were 16 or 18? And the answer is probably not. So the artists that were big 20 years ago And their fan base at that time was 15, 16, 18, 20. Those same people, number one, are not going to be checking for them now in their 40s like they were back then. But two, the young new audience, which is the audience that spends money, mm-hmm. and which is the bulk of the people coming to shows and buying new music, they're not checking for you. Not the same way as they are other artists that are in their early 20s or 18 or whatever
That's just what it is. They're not checking for you. They're just not. And that's a reality check, man, for a lot of older artists. You know, because like I said, there's a difference between rappers and artists that rap. Because artists, when I say artists, artists know the game. They know the hard work it takes to put in. It's a constant daily grind. There's no days off, really, mentally, at all. And, you know, you really are, you stand to the grindstone. But I don't know, like I say, with the numbers and everything like that, man, I employ older artists to really look at themselves in the mirror and see what they're really in it for. And if you're really in it for the right reasons, you know it's always, you're on a grindstone because you're working harder than the new guy.
Right.
Really, because the new guy is who's being accepted. And so you got to work twice as hard to make sure they respect your vet. You know, they respect your get down. Right. So, you know, when I see this stuff, me and JP just sit back and we be on some chuckling.
Right, right.
Funny to me.
No, it is. And to add to what Psycho was just saying is, you know, you have to grow and evolve with the game. And the best example I can give is look at the social, or the internet and social media platforms that are out now that kids just grow up on. They five knowing how to, you know, jump on the internet and mm-hmm. navigate, you know, social media platforms or new technology of all kinds. You know what I mean? Like the new style video games. You throw me on one of these new video games, these fantasy video, I don't know how to fucking play.
No.
I'm still trying to play Super Mario. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So what I'm saying is that with the advent of technology and as things progress, the youth have an advantage because they're coming into the game. All they know is how it is now. So it's not like they're trying to break old habits or learn new things. This is all they know. But when you're veterans like us, we have to work twice as hard to learn the new ways to do shit and you know, against our set in ways to sometimes stop doing things that we used to do that we thought worked or did work, you mm-hmm. know, 10 mm-hmm. years ago, but it doesn't work now. You can't go to Venice Beach with CDRs and try to sling that shit to, you know, tourists. Like, people will think you're fucking weird,
right,
because
real
that shit is old way of promoting. You can't do that. You know, that's like you getting on MySpace right now and trying to pump your shit on MySpace and get people to add your MySpace page. You would be looked at as crazy. Like, what planet did you go? Have you been in the pen for 10 years, 15 years and just came out and didn't realize MySpace is deader than a doornail?
Right, right. Like a motherfucker hitting you up. Hey, man, check out my A-track.
Right. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, you got to stay on your game. And I think the bottom line of this whole podcast is, one, as an artist, recognize your true numbers mm-hmm. and then work on ways to actually boost those numbers organically and realistically.
Real shit.
But two, if you're a promoter or another artist or a venue owner who's looking to work with artists, work with talent, for whatever situation you're trying to do, do your investigation in numbers. If an artist is making claims to you like, hey man, you know, I charge $800 for a collab because, you know, I'm whoop-de-whoop, you know, 15 years ago I was a somebody, and you're like, shit, you know, I remember this guy did a song with such and such who's this big guy. I remember this guy. But that was then. Look at their numbers now, because if this dude has only, you know, go to Spotify, only has 100 monthly listeners, you go to his YouTube And he doesn't really have a lot cracking on his YouTube or you know, his other social media, then chances are you paying that $800 or that $1,000 to get this artist who used to be this you know, big thing on your record now, you're probably not even going to get back 10% of what you're putting in to pay for that collab or to get him on that show.
Exactly.
And to that artist that's charging overinflated prices, it's the, you know, you may get over on people once, but once they realize that you're not worth that number that you quoted and got paid, you're probably never getting booked again for whatever that is or getting hit up for that collab again. And for me, I would rather have longevity in working with people, knowing my worth and trying to build, obviously, my worth, but knowing my worth at this moment and telling an artist, like, this is what I pull at a show. These are my numbers right now. You know, let's do work. This is my price, you know, to work with me, because I want them to be happy with what I bring to the table. And they'll be like, you know, JP is honest and upfront, and he's building up his fan base and doing what he does. And so I would invite him back on another show or get him on another collab or whatever. And to me, it's about having that reoccurring longevity of business versus I'm going to get over on this dude this one time. But no, I'm never going to have business with these people again.
That's crazy. And that's what happens, man. And, you know, you did touch on a subject about, you know, the old ways of how things used to work. Like, you know, these artists would get signed to a label, and the label, you know, it had artist development teams on there, A&R departments, all these little things to help build an artist before they even release an album. You know, it would take a few years to get a new artist to even get into the get off the bench, to put me in the coach, you know, put me in coach,
right,
I'm ready to play.
Right.
So the point I'm making is those models, those business models that how they worked on artists back in those days, out of here.
Right.
Out of here.
Right.
They don't do that no more.
Right.
Labels do not sign real, and there's only four real big labels out there right now, as far as mainstream major labels. And it's like, if you don't have that steam coming up from yourself, you're not a self-sufficient promoter of your own brand, they're not messing with you. They're like, you didn't do the groundwork, because they want people who already got the groundwork going. So it makes it easy for them to go ahead and invest their money and make things pop. But if you're new, starting from scratch, and you think the label's gonna take care of you and all that stuff like that, you are absolutely delusional. It's not the time.